Good morning. Welcome. Let me be the first to express gratitude from the family for those of you who are here or watching online today. Kyle McQuillan touched a lot of lives in a lot of different ways. If we were to each tell our own story, we'd be here a long time. But I know the family is grateful that you are here and representing the fact that Kyle had an influence in your life. It reminds me that God's plan is still the same. It's one life touching another life. I also want to be able to express our sense of loss to the family from our church. Kyle was on staff here, you know, for 17 or 18 years. He helped us through some very difficult transitions, for those of you who've been around that long. He was kind of like the rock of Gibraltar and helped us through a lot of those difficult days. And we will always be indebted to him for all of that and his friendship and all that he's done for us as a church. And so we come with a sense of loss, even though it's been over a year that Kyle went to be with the Lord. We still feel that sense of loss. We should feel a sense of loss in that someone we loved is no longer with us. That's God's plan, right? We love people, they love us, they're not here anymore, we should feel something. It's called loss. But we also come with a sense of praise to God, because as we know that Kyle is not here with us, we know that he is with his Savior. And so we give praise to God for that. Marlouise, I've been anticipating this day for a long time. And I don't mean anticipating like, ha-ha, can't wait till it happens kind of day. I've been anticipating it with dread because for 15 years, Kyle has showed me the program and reminded me what I'm supposed to do on this day. And I would tell him on many occasions, I say, Kyle, A, there's no guarantee that, you know, I'm going to outlive you. So just remind yourself of that. B, once you're gone, we can do anything we want. True, though, to Kyle and all that he meant to us, we are pretty much sticking to his script today. We're leaving a couple of things out, but he has no leverage right now where he's at, so we're going to do it the way we want. I've asked Pastor Connor if he would come and lead us in a word of prayer this morning, Connor.
God, thank you for Kyle's life. Thank you for what it meant to so many people. Thank you for how you blessed us through him. And now as we spend these next moments together remembering Kyle, I pray that we would also remember the faith that he had in you, and how you used him to bring change to people's lives, to bring hope to people's lives, to bring love to people's lives. And I pray that in this time, we would be challenged to live in the good ways that Kyle himself lived. And so we pray that you would bless this gathering together. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, I'm going to invite Doris Swift to come up and read some scripture passages for us.
I've been attending EAC for 20 years, but I joined the staff in 2012, and that's when I really got to know Kyle. And we're going to miss his calm wisdom in the office, but I certainly miss his sense of humor. He was always making things fun, and I remember a time where he heard my car pulling up, and he went and sat in the front office in the dark. And when I opened the door to come in, he said, "Hello, Doris." And I jumped out of my skin, and then he flipped the light on, and he was always trying to feed us. He wanted to make sure we were well fed with Marlowe's wonderful food and Tony's food and leftovers from Leanne's, and he promised Cheryl and I that, for one thing, he took all the calories out, and another thing, that it was going to be gluten-free no matter what it was. So we sure missed that. And he oftentimes would ask me to read scripture at the services that he would officiate over. And sometimes I knew the family and sometimes I didn't. And sometimes they didn't know me. So I would get up and read scripture and they were probably going, who is that? What side of the family is she from? But I am blessed and honored to be able to read scripture today because he had asked me if I would at his service. And after going la, 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 because I didn't want to really hear about it or like what Ron was saying about the program, he would come and show me the program. See, I've got it all set. All you have to do is fill in the date. It's like, no. But anyway, so I think it was a blessing that the date was 3/16. And so here are some scriptures that I'm sure that Kyle had read oftentimes to comfort families, and now they are going to be here to comfort us. John 14:1-6. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you, because I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I am coming again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you, there you also will be. And you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Psalm 62:5-8. My soul, wait in silence for God alone, for my hope is from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my refuge. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my glory rest on God. The rock of my strength, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is a refuge for us. Selah. Romans 8:35-39. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or trouble or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Just as it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We were regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you, Doris. One of the songs that Kyle wanted us to sing today is one of our favorites probably as well. Amazing Grace, how sweet is that? Sing it with me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will we've been there, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun. Than when we'd first begun.
It seems unfair to me that I am the only person who gets to give a talk this morning with the subject title, Remembering Kyle. Since that is the case, however, it is my desire that in this time we remember him together, that my memories of Kyle will prompt memories of your own. And so I invite you, while I speak, to allow yourself to be distracted by your own memories of Kyle, to daydream and think back to special times you shared with him, bouncing back and forth between my memories of Kyle and your own. There are memories of Kyle that are unique to me, but the man behind the memories is a gift that we share. If you want a biographical overview of Kyle's remarkable life, you can find one in the bulletin. For the remaining moments of my time with you, I will remember the Kyle that I knew, that I loved, and love still. It will not come as a surprise for you to hear, likely, that Kyle and I became fast friends. This seems to be the normative way. In fact, Kyle made his friends. He made his friends quite quickly. It was almost as if I didn't have a choice in the matter. Like Kyle was going to be my friend, whether I asked for his friendship or not. I remember one time, the first time he ever came to my house, he drove to my house to drop off grapes for my daughter, Chloe, simply because he knew she liked grapes. Who does that? Kyle McQuillan does that. He inserted his friendship into your life, but his friendship was a welcomed intruder. Kyle did friendship differently than most people you will ever meet. That is to say, Kyle did friendship well. Friendship seemed so natural, so effortless to Kyle that we might be tempted to conclude that's just who Kyle was, or that's just how God gifted him to be. And while there might be some truth to that, relationships were the priority of Kyle's life, and they got the best of his attention. As I reflect on our friendship, it's kind of humorous to me, frankly. Like, how often in culture do you see a guy in his mid-20s and a guy in his mid-70s just hanging out as friends? But in a true sense of the word, we really were that, friends. I mean, I admired him. I respected him. I wanted to learn from his wisdom, but I truly enjoyed his presence. I had him over for dinner. We would grab lunch together. I once had a Super Bowl party in which the only invitees were Kyle McQuillan and Tony Plett. He was my friend, and I enjoyed his friendship. Part of the reason I enjoyed his friendship as much as I did was because Kyle was genuinely fun to be around. He liked to laugh, and I liked to play jokes on him. One of my favorite jokes to play on him was to sneak into his office when he left to use the restroom or to meet with someone and tell his Echo Dot to play something loudly that probably should not be played in the church office. I would walk in and I would say something along the lines of, "Echo, play Snoop Dogg, Volume 8. And I would sneak out, and Kyle would return to this rap music or whatever, coming out of his office and going down the hallway. He never got mad. He seemed to appreciate the fun that we shared. He liked to laugh, and he did it frequently. He made other people laugh too, as Doris has just mentioned, sometimes by saying stuff that others of us couldn't get away with, but he could because he was Kyle. For example, Nate will remember this. He liked to surprise people by using slang terms he learned from his time doing prison ministry. That would catch people off guard. Kyle was a lot younger than his age. Mark Twain once said, "Most men die at 27. We just bury them at 72. Not so with Kyle. His spirit didn't age like most people's do. He had a youthful whimsy about him. He got excited about food. In fact, that was one of the loves we shared. Particularly, we bonded over spicy food, hot sauce, and curry. He liked technology. He was intrigued by it and wanted to learn how to use it. He was interested in new movies, new books, new TV shows. While Kyle's body aged, there was something about him that remained young." I think many of you know what I am talking about. Kyle was special. He lived a special life. The way Kyle loved people, it wasn't normal. It was abnormal. It was unique. I would argue that it was actually supernatural. That it was the result of the loving relationship Kyle had with God through Jesus Christ. Kyle could be very encouraging, couldn't he? Kyle was a significant encouragement to me. And since you're here, I'm going to guess and assume he was a significant encouragement to you also. He encouraged me as a minister of the gospel. He affirmed my preaching. He told me he believed God was going to do great things in my life, and that means a lot coming from Kyle. And so he encouraged me significantly as it came to my public ministry, which for many preachers is the focus of their life. But Kyle, while he was dying, in one of the final correspondences I would ever have with the man I loved this side of heaven, he said, "Connor, whatever you do, that would include whatever sermons you preach, whatever ministries you lead," he says, "the most important thing in your life is that you love people really well. That you love them. Genuinely love the people that God has put into your life." As Kyle was nearing the end of his life on earth, that's what he was thinking about, loving people well. How well did Kyle McQuillan model that for us? He modeled it for me. He modeled it for you. And if there is anything at all, that you remember from Kyle's life, I think he would want it to be this. That he was loved deeply by Jesus. And he lived out of that love he received and extended it to others. And he did that well. And if there's anything that we should remember from Kyle, it's the love that came from Christ through Kyle to us.
Thank you, Connor. I want to read just a few verses for you from Revelation chapter 21. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men. And he shall dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be among them. And he shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall no longer be any death. There shall no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away." And he who sits on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." And he said, "Write, for these words are faithful and true." John writes this in the first century as a first century Jew. One of the, as he thinks about the vision of the end of eternity, or maybe the beginning of eternity, however you look at it, he sees a new heaven and a new earth. And he makes one little phrase in there that always bothered me, and it said, there is no sea. You know, as a guy that grew up here in Daytona Beach, I spent a lot of time on the sea here. And it used to bother me as a young man thinking, man, now let me see, if there's no oceans in heaven, then there's no waves in heaven. It means there's no surfing in heaven. What are we going to do for all that time? But then I realized that John, as a first century Jew, is probably writing allegorically, because you see, for him, the sea was not something positive. It was almost something negative. There was something symbolically negative about the sea for John. Why was that? Because for the first century Jew, the sea was mysterious. Nobody had conquered the sea yet. We didn't have Jacques Cousteau. We didn't have all of the underground oceanic expeditions where we've seen some of the depths of the oceans. Even now, with all that we've seen, it still is a great mystery, isn't it? I can remember going out surfing one time when I was about 16, and I was like one of the first guys out. It was one of those glassy days. For those of you who ever surfed or go on a boat, you know those days. Sun had just come up. I'm sitting on my board out there, but Sunglow Pier by myself. Quiet, not any wind at all. And 5 feet away from me, the biggest sea turtle in the world comes out of the air. Scares me half to death. You never know what's down there, do you? The sea is mysterious. But John said there is no more sea. What's he saying? There's no more mystery. For Kyle, there's no more mystery. His questions have been answered. One look into his Savior's face, all the disappointments, all the questions are gone. You know how he used to always say, and it used to probably drive most of us crazy, look here, right? He's always showing us something, look here. Well, I think maybe for the first time in his life, there's a lot of other people saying to him, "Hey, Kyle, look here, look here." And he's understanding what it is, that though we look through a glass dimly, then face to face. No more mystery. The other thing for the first century Jew was that the ocean was dangerous. You know, you could start out on a beautiful, calm day, but by the end of that day, if the seas get high and the winds get high, suddenly that small, that smooth surface of an ocean becomes very dangerous. For many first century Jews, they still felt, what was that, the end of the horizon? That could have been the end of the world. And it was a dangerous place to be. But John says there's no more sea. There's no more danger. Kyle doesn't have to worry about his blood count, his platelets. He doesn't have to worry about getting another transfusion, another infusion. No more danger. What's going to happen to me next week if I can't get a transfusion? He has to worry about that anymore. All danger is past. As the hymn writer said, he is safe in the arms of Jesus. Our culture says that we are in the land of the living, headed to the land of the dying. Jesus came to reverse that, to remind us that we are in the land of the dying. We're headed to the land of the living. And we can believe that today because Jesus once said it at a funeral himself. Though a man dies, he shall live. And that's what Kyle is. It has been said, life is difficult. God is merciful. Heaven is sure. Kyle has experienced all of those things. We are thankful for his life. I think for most of us who are over 50 here today, it is a reminder that God's work for us is never done. We can still have an impact on people when we're 80 or older, that God still has something for us to do. Kyle taught me that. One of the songs he wanted us to sing today was one that is more than a song. I think it's a great theological treatise of really where our hope really is. In Christ alone, I put my trust. I'm going to ask you to stand. Let's sing it together.
For I am his and he is mine. with the precious blood of Christ.
On Christ the solid.
On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
No guilt in life.
No guilt in life. No fear in death. Here is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Till
he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
Amen. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we don't put our trust in our feelings. We don't put our trust in what we can do and what we can't do. All that Kyle was and is, Lord, we thank you that he loved you and you redeemed him. And now, Lord, he is with you. We celebrate his life. We ask you, Lord, that he would be an example to us who are still on this earth. We would live our life in such a way that we truly love people well and look to you, Lord, for that which you want to use us to do. I pray for the family today. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would surround them with your peace and your grace. I pray in their moments still ahead, perhaps, of deep loss, that they would be reminded that Kyle is home safe. And that although life can be difficult, that you are a merciful God. And for those of us who know you, as Kyle did, heaven is sure. May we go in that peace today, for it is in your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask the family to go out first, if you would. Keith, if you'd lead the way out of here for them. If you have not had a chance to speak to them yet, they'll be out there in the foyer. And please feel free to stop by and say some kind words, if you would. Maybe some remembrances of Kyle and all that he meant to us. I want to again just thank you for coming here today and being a part, showing support to the family. I know it means an awful lot to them, and that you would take time today on this Saturday to be here for you. God bless you.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. I will rise. drawing near. When this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb. And I
I will rise when He calls my name.